your hand out there. Make some noise. Hype it up.
Exodus chapter 14, real quick. Exodus chapter 14. And if I must, for those of you who are critical of preachers, take a subject. It is going to be go forward. Let's see here. Lord, because the meat of that, let me see here. This is good word. We'll just read it. Praise the Lord. We're such in a victorious season. But go to Exodus chapter 14. While you're there, stay there for a moment. Where is Brother Ian? I want to thank God for him because Pastor came in this morning just dealing with a lot this morning. So I got the chance to talk with Deacon Jason. We're sharing some things at the table, and the Lord through him was just really blessing me too. But Brother Ian, I just added the clear blue. It appeared like that so that you understand what Pastor's saying. He walked up and he says, can I show you something? I said, yeah. And so he showed me, he was going to show me his phone, and there was the most beautiful devotion written, and it spoke exactly to where I was. And I took my time to read it, you know, from the beginning to the end, and I said, God, thank you, because we pray all the time for God to guide us and direct us, and we let the Lord know we want to hear him. And what's awesome about God is we're learning, even experiencing God, is he comes in the most awesome of ways. So I'm just so grateful to God. Thank you, Brother Ian, for being submitted to the Holy Spirit and just doing that. It's just amazing. You know, the first thing that caught my attention was he was serving today in the culinary ministry. And I don't want to make too much of it because I've been around church long enough to know if you start pumping people and you discourage them and they leave you. So I said, I just leave them. And I just said, God, I thank you for him serving. But it was just amazing. Just when I was sitting there, and you got to know, I mean, I was getting, sharing with Deacon Jason, I was getting all types of bogus phone calls this morning, just all types of stuff. And if you're not careful, that can weigh you down. And I'm kind of learning just to turn my phone off, and I get it after I deliver, praise the Lord, because it can just wear you out. But I thank God for that young man this morning. Sharing and just being obedient to the Holy Spirit. Amen. So go forward. Let's see if we can work this for the next few moments. It's 12:29. I'm going to get you in and move on. Praise the Lord. Exodus chapter 14. And this is so good. If you'd just allow me, I think I'm a pretty quick reader. I just want to start at verse 1 and move on through what God has given to us to share with you. The Bible says in verse 1, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speaking to the children of Israel, that they turn and encamp before Pahahiroth, between Migdol and the sea, over against Baal Zephon, before it ye shall encamp by the sea. Verse 3, for Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land, the wilderness hath shut them in. Okay. Now, let's take some time to enjoy what we just read. Just for a moment, there's more. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land. The wilderness have shut them in. Let me share this with you as we move from 2:13 to 2:14. And I'm very careful not to be clichéist and all that kind of stuff, because there's a lot of times people are saying God said stuff that he didn't say. when you feel as though your back is against the wall, it is a classic case God to show up. Amen. Everybody got that? Now, I want you to understand this too, for all of us who have gone through some stuff in 2013, if God, Lord, okay, let me say it this way. If Satan was truly in control, you would have been dead.
Amen.
It is important that we understand, Kiana, that there is work for us to do, Pastor Embry. And that no matter how intense the fight is, Nikita, it's not over, Robert, until God says so.
All right.
Be careful not to feed your fear. When you feed your fear, you infect your faith. So again, what I want to put you in remembrance of this is this. If God has said something concerning your life, it is going to come to pass.
Amen.
Number two, and I'm just on that verse three right now. It might appear as if all doors are closed, nothing's going on, it's over, you can hang up your shoes and everything else, but let me tell you something. God, if God said he's bringing you to a better place, God is bringing you to a better place. And what most people do is they don't understand, they don't know what to do when pressure starts to hit them. A lot of times when pressure starts to hit you and the situation looks very bleak, stop. Don't try to make any moves. Don't try to make any decisions. Just stop and keep bombarding heaven until God gives you a release.
Amen.
He says, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart. See that there are pieces to this puzzle, Elder Harris, that we don't know. There are conversations that are happening, Brother Swan, about us that we have not been privy to. And by the time I finish today, I'm sure I will have done a good job of helping you to see all of what you already are looking for and you need. It's already done.
Amen.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I will harden Pharaoh's heart that he shall follow after them, and I will be honored upon Pharaoh. Good cook-a-mugga. That's what God is after. We serve an awesome God.
Amen.
You may be just being used, but the real deal is God is only using you, to send a clear message to the enemy.
Amen. Mm.
Amen.
He says, and I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his hosts that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord.
Amen.
Have you ever felt like you were in a place, everything else was dark and you the only light up in there?
Yeah.
Amen. Let me move on. He says that I am the Lord. And they did so. And it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and of his servants was turned against the people. And they said, why have we done this that we have let Israel go from serving us?
Mm.
And he made ready his chariot and took his people with him. And he took 600 chosen chariots and all the chariots of Egypt and captains over every one of them. Now, let's stop there for a minute. Let me tell you something. Pharaoh was going to get them. It was in his mind he was going to bring back everything that he had allowed to leave.
Yeah.
But let me tell you this too, Nikki, that when God delivers you, you ain't got to worry about Satan.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Shamika, I need to say that again. When God delivers you, you don't have to worry about Satan.
Amen.
When God delivers you, you don't have to worry about Satan. What am I saying? In essence, God can take care of Satan. Because what many of us do, we keep worrying. Oh, God, help me, Holy Spirit, to deliver this thing. We keep worrying about what's going to happen.
Yes.
We keep worrying about what has not happened.
Yes.
We keep worrying about stuff that God didn't ordain for us to worry about. Just, oh, man. Yes. What he's trying to share with us today, Joe, is just live today. Live for this moment. Because, God, help me, Holy Spirit, if God wanted you to know all of that, he would tell you all of that.
Amen.
Mm, this is good. Yes, Lord, yes. Says here, verse 8, and the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued after the children of Israel, and the children of Israel went out with a high hand. I like that about God. He's a show off.
Amen.
I like that about God. He's not going to go out quietly. I like that about God because he always has bragging rights. I like that about God because he usually shows up at the bottom of the ninth. I like that about God because he usually chooses to show up at the end of the fourth quarter. Time is almost out and it's almost just enough time for a miracle. That's what I like about God. But the Egyptians pursued after them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh. That's a lot. And his horsemen and his army, and overtook them in camping by the sea beside Pihahiroth before Baal Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes. And behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were so afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. Do we know who we serve?
Yes.
No, no, really. No, I know you go to church, but do you know who you serve?
Yes.
I know you think you know what you're supposed to be doing, but no, really, there's a difference. Do you know who you serve?
Yes.
See, I can tell who knows who they serve by your conversation.
Come on.
And I'm not saying you don't have challenging times sometimes in your life. But for the most part, you know, if you have enough word in you, it'll kick back in and start reminding you, don't you say that. You might feel that way, but don't you confess that. I think I got some witnesses in here. Mm-hmm. Children of Israel cried out unto the Lord, and they said, unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Now let me tell y'all something. They done seen enough miracles, far as I'm concerned. Yes. Amen. And listen, before you throw off at them, check yourself. Because how many of y'all know God done brought you to listen, if we would just go down memory lane in 2013, God did enough stuff for us to know that he can do it again in 2014. But as I check us, as I do just a little, you know, spiritual check, some of us struggling, and it's just January 5th.
Amen, amen.
I mean, we 5 days into the new year and have already given up. What is it? 4th, thank y'all very much. January 4th, that's even worse. And have already. You know I'm telling the truth. You're stressing and you're worrying. Some of you, you don't have to tell everybody, some of you, you know your money got short this year, and God still made a way. Some of you, there were health challenges that you faced, and God still made a way. Come on. Some of you, you counted people out, and they're still surviving. They're still here. Come on. And if God can do it in 2013, he can definitely do it. I was listening to Bishop Gilbert Patterson share maybe 2.5 years before he passed. It was a little less than that. A few months before he passed. He was sharing how when he got diagnosed with prostate cancer, he asked the doctor, you know, how long do I have? He says, usually maybe about 2 years or so. And so he began to testify about how he had gone 2 years plus.
Amen. Amen.
He stepped back and he told the church, he said, that's just to let you know that you ain't going nowhere until God says so.
Amen.
Satan can develop assignment after assignment after assignment, but every single time they're going to fail because God's in charge.
Amen.
And then I got to thinking about Bishop Smith and how he's been battling this thing for 7 years and still going strong.
Amen.
I just talked to my mother yesterday. I like to give you all updates every now and then. Just talked to my mother yesterday. She said, Mike, she said, well, the day before yesterday, she says, you know, I'm tired. She said, but I got good news for you. She said, it's shrinking. I said, to God be the glory. This is how church folk will do you. Verse 12, is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone? Now, I've got to stay at the mic for this one, because this is where y'all make pastoring hard. Do you honestly think this man of God, first of all, let's just have some fun with this. Let me just be free today. First of all, do you think Moses even wanted to be their pastor?
No.
I mean, let's just stop and think about that. And then all of the weight and the responsibility that comes behind that, trust me, on his best day, think about the conversations that he and God would have.
Amen.
For him to say, God, they're your people. And God say, no, they're your people. I mean, think about that. See, when y'all come to us, and yes, we give it to the Lord and whatnot, there's only one place for me to go, and that's to God. And if we ever get to the place where God, Jeff, doesn't want to take ownership over y'all, we in trouble.
Yeah.
They got nerve to tell Moses, we told you this, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians. Now, look at that. This is the challenge for the church, Minister Stewart. I get this all the time. God gives me vision for the church, direction for the church, but you know what keeps happening? You can tell. You know, the Bible says without a vision, the people perish. What happens oftentimes is while I got a vision that God has given to me, you got one too.
God.
I really wouldn't have to stay here long if I'd get more amens. But I think what happens is as I'm delivering the words, the people start saying, ooh, he talking about me. Yeah, I mean, come on. You got a vision about how it's supposed to work. And you got a vision about how it's supposed to. Come on, talk to me, church. Y'all know. And then we start to have a problem. I like to call them sideline pastors. What they call a Monday morning quarterbacking? What, verse 12? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians. Oh, God. This text almost overwhelms me, and I'm going to tell you in a minute why. For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And pray for Pastor if you don't agree, but I spend a considerable amount of time reading. And one of the things that I read, quite frankly, a bit is CNN. Keeps me abreast of different things that are going on. And, I want to be very careful about this because I tried to research to make sure this stuff is true. But there's been a number of things lurking in the air about the Pope, things that he supposedly said and things of that nature. And not because I can't defend the scriptures, share with you what the word says, but even as I hear off-the-wall stuff, the Holy Spirit ministers to me and lets me know, but I know better. Now let me, and I'm gonna pick up on this when I deal with, are you useful or useless, from Peter. But I want to caution you about something that the Holy Spirit convicted me concerning. My wife and I were in bed and we were watching TV, and I share this because you have got to guard your eyes, you got to guard your ears, because there's a clear agenda. The enemy wants to water down the word of God, where we truly start to think that everything goes and everything is all right, and it's not. I don't want to apologize. I know it's the word of God. And so we got to stand on the word of God. So I don't care if the Pope's grandmother says something that doesn't line up with scripture. It's wrong. Now, I say that because in verse 12 here, my heart bleeds, because there are people who are going to feel like Brother Hunter, that it's better to do wrong than it is right. You're going to feel outnumbered. Okay, let me get back. So First Lady and I went to bed, we were watching TV, and it's the show we like to watch. What's that one, honey, with the gay couple? Yeah, Modern Family. It's absolutely hilarious. I mean, just think, whoever writes it, oh, they're brilliant. It's just hilarious. But I found myself, not knocking, judging any of y'all, because you got different capacities. I found myself really, really enjoying the characters, and when I say that, it's becoming more normal the more I watch it. And then the more normal it becomes, the more accepting. Amen. I had to stop. Watch this now. This past month, I had to check my spirit real quick. Because watch this now. Watch this, especially for those who are televised and don't know Pastor Smith as well as those who are here today. What I'm simply saying is this: as I shared with a friend of mine at work, I said, listen, here's how I see this homosexual agenda. Because people can come. You can come to this church. I'm going to love you. I'm going to say that again in the mic. I am going to love you. Now, my loving you doesn't mean that I'm going to condone your behavior if you want to continue to practice that, any more than I will condone a person who's an adulterer, a person who is a liar, a person who steals. All of it's wrong. But here's why you don't hear me beating up on people who lie, who steal, or who commit adultery that I know of. We don't have any churches out here where they're willing to open up their doors and preach about everything but adultery because you're struggling with it. We don't have First Church of Liars where you can come and we'll preach about everything except for lying because you're struggling with it. You get my point? But we do have churches open up where you got the first G or the first gentleman and wives and husbands. No, that's not right according to God's word. And I love you. And my name is not Phil Robertson. I love you. But we got to stand for what's right. I'm all for people. Listen, this is honest to God truth, and I'm very careful about what I dispense. I'm all for people. If you guys are partners and you want to share benefits, be encouraged. I work for an insurance company. I think you should share benefits. Amen. That's the honest to God truth. Amen. Y'all been together with each other. You done build a life together. Be encouraged. But if you want... Please, I'm really trying to fix it to the point where people know I love people, but I'm committed to tell the truth. I'm not gonna say something different because I love you and you're my family member. You're struggling. If you don't confess and ask the Lord to forgive you and ask the Lord to help you, then according to this book, there's only one place for you. Let me, God, this is the trouble of knowing the word. Let me just deviate for a minute. Peter tells us this, and I'm convinced that one or two things is happening. Either the Bible is true, Pastor Embry, or Shane, God lied.
Amen. Amen.
And here's why I said it, and I'm going to get into it because I got some fun stuff for y'all. Praise. It ain't all that rough and that deep, but I just got to go the way the Holy Spirit is leading me. I want you to know that Peter talks to us about this. And he says this, that there are things. Now, watch this now, Jeff. God says to add to your faith. That means that you have to first have faith in order to add to it. Now, I could go all the way down, verse by verse by verse, but I want to, I share that essentially, Bobo, because I want to get to this place. I want the church to understand that you can live a fail-proof life. Listen, listen. God would not have ever said that if it was not possible.
Amen.
Because he watches, he says, if you do all of those things, you'll never be barren or unfruitful in Christ.
Amen.
It's important for us to remember that you can do what the word says. Otherwise, God would have never given it to us. He would have never told us. Now, let me help you out, because that just doesn't speak to just anybody, you know, dealing with homosexuality. That speaks to anybody who is in a single lifestyle as well as anybody who is in a married lifestyle. You don't have to step outside of your marriage, praise the Lord. Come on, somebody. That's a choice. You can walk with God if you choose to. Watch this, watch this. Every person that I have seen fall, they fell because it was a decision that was made. Now, I want to caution the church. Please do not buy into this watered-down gospel that's being preached, because you cannot do everything that you want to do and not be accountable to God. Oh, you're going to be accountable to God.
Yeah.
I mean, we can love you, praise the Lord. I say what I got to say, and it's still the word of God, but you're going to be accountable to God.
Yeah.
God ain't going to bless me, and I'm treating First Lady like she a piece of trash.
Amen.
God ain't going to bless me and continue to bless me if I treat Michael and Michaela bad. That's my first ministry. Before I ever come in this pulpit and tell you anything, I better be taking care of home. And I appreciate the type of church that helps keep your pastor accountable. Amen. You see me getting ready to get set up, I don't mind you saying, Elder, I'll take care of it. I'll get it. Praise the Lord. Especially some of you sisters, I'm just using that as an example. You know somebody, their heart ain't right. Elder will take care of it. I got enough wisdom in me to step back and say, okay, Mama Gail, thank you. You would want to be helped, I would think, because he keeps saying, add to your faith virtue, add to your faith this. And so the people that have fallen have chosen not to add. It says here, let me get to this. Lord, this is good. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you this day, or he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. Goodness. Underline verse 14. The Lord shall fight for you. And ye shall hold. Good. Cook-a-mugga. I'm going to read that again. You ain't got to fight for yourself. The Lord. Jeff, I'm going to need you today. I feel like hollering just a little bit. Just follow me. My habit is to go up and come back down, but just follow me today. I'm going to have to work it today. The Lord shall fight for you. Yep. Take my time. I was watching Bishop Hezekiah Walker. He dressed like this, Chuck. I was watching Israel Houghton. He dressed like this, and I thought it'd be okay for Pastor Smith to wear his shirt out with some y'all not talking. The Lord shall fight for you. So that tells me, Nikita, don't waste my energy. That tells me, LaKendra, that during this season, I don't have to fight. Elder Harris, the time that I'm spending trying to develop a strategy is wasted time, because God's already got it worked out. Whew. He says, now this part means something to me, April, because this is where I've been struggling. This is where I've been struggling. Geneva, I got myself in situations where I wasn't holding my peace. And when I say that, I wasn't fighting anybody, but I was letting my peace go. And I'm talking about my peace of mind. I'm talking about the peace God gave to me, because I was trying to figure out, how's it going to work out? Well, God, why you allow that to happen? Well, God, this and what? That, guess what? Ain't none of that my business. Have you ever had situations where God allow stuff to happen to you, and he wants you to remain cool, calm, Never forget, I was watching Bishop Jason was preaching. He was saying one time he was an adjutant for his bishop. And he said he got a call one time, they were on the road, got a call one time, either church caught on fire or somebody broke into the church or something. And he said, Bishop, you know, was driving. He said, okay. He said, no problem. He said, well, call the police, whatever case may be. And he told Bishop Jakes, he said, now he's in another city now, another state. Now he says, drive me over to such and such giant, he said, because I want to get some grapes.
Amen.
Bishop Jakes said, the church, y'all will get the vision in a minute. Amen. He said, Bishop just politely said, drive me over to the giant and get me some grapes.
Amen.
And he told Bishop, Bishop Jakes, he said, he told him, he said, ain't no sense of me stressing and worrying about it. I can't do nothing from where I am. This is why I like talking to Sherry a lot of times. God uses her to help keep me grounded. I have stuff on my mind. And Sherry, you know, we talked to, we prayed about it. God got it all in control. I come in, I mean, waited down. I said, God, I got it. I be trying to, I said, God, can I have a what some of Sherry? Listen, church, listen. Might sound funny, but it's true. God says, hold your peace.
Yes.
Now, if he tells you to hold it, it's possible for it to be taken.
Yes.
If you give it away.
Wow.
You know why that's important? Because there are a lot of Christians walking around here defeated, and that's not God's will for your life because you keep giving what he gave to you. I'm almost there, y'all. I'm almost there. God help me today. Verse 15. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? That's what I like. The church missed that one. Watch what God said to Moses. He said, what you talking to me for? I don't think y'all caught that. God is trying to tell us to stop praying about stuff he done already worked out. He done already taken. God. Oh, I wish the church could get into it. I wish. God help me. Yes, Lord. Help him to get it, God. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore Christ? Stop acting like a crybaby. Stop complaining about stuff. Come on. Walk with me, y'all. See, we forgot. What's today, y'all? January 4th? We forgot what the Lord did for us in 2013. Sister Anna's not able to be here today, but her mother, they had counted her for today, unto death. She's still living.
Amen.
Hold on. I want the church to hear me. When I went to see Mother Gwen Harris, she's telling me how her leg just kept swelling up. She couldn't even walk on it. Now, she says she knew medically what the doctors would need to do to get it to come down. Do you know, she told me, she said that the Lord, the doctor told her, that he referred to the divine one, I believe it was, said, you know what, somebody divine or the divine one actually went into your leg, made the incision that needed to be made. Her leg started going back down by itself. Tell me we don't serve an awesome God. She didn't even have to have the operation because God fought for her. God made the way. God got involved. So he says here in verse 15, and the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward.
Amen.
Are you kidding me?
Amen.
No, seriously, are you kidding me? Speaking to the children of Israel that they go where?
Forward.
I need everybody to have a Bible to meditate on chapter 15, I mean verse 15. And that B portion of it, I'm going to read it one more time. Speaking to the children of Israel that they go
forward.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, sister. What's your name? Get on, Mr. Kiana. Thank you so much, sister. I'm going to try that one more time because I need some help up in here. Speak unto the children of Israel that they go
forward.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mother Bennett. All right. So let me ask y'all a question. When you know God's will, why is it? I'm gonna be nice to you. God's saying, go where?
Forward.
I'm gonna try that one more time. God is saying, go where?
Forward.
Okay, I need your help. For the next few scriptures I'm gonna share with you, I'm gonna need your help because I'm gonna show you some stuff and I know it's gonna bless you because it blessed me and it's the word of God. God say, go where?
Forward.
Okay, all right. Now notice he tells you to go forward at a time for which you don't feel like it.
Amen.
And notice he tells you to go forward at a time for which, I'm serious, it don't even look like you need to go forward. And how many, okay, listen, please. How many of y'all are sick and tired of doing what's right and it seemed like your season didn't come? Come on, don't be no Christian punk. Come on and tell me, praise God. Listen, I can hear some of the conversations you have with God because he'll show me. How many of you tired of doing the right thing? Because see, if what I was sharing wasn't truth, there would have been no reason for him to say, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. There would have been no reason for the writer to say, be not weary in well-doing for in... Okay. Ye shall what? Okay. All right. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So let's do this. I shared with you that it's already done and God is saying what? Okay. One more time. Do y'all believe God's got it all under control? Do you really believe that God has your best interest in heart in mind? I mean, you got to know that, church. Come on. Do you really know that God has your best interest? Please. Pastor, thank you so much. He said, Elder, come on. He created me. But you know what, church? I don't want us to live beneath our privilege. Do you really, really believe God has your best interest in mind?
Yeah.
All right. Now, watch this now. Not only that, what I want to get to is this, Sister Grant. Then stop fighting him. See, because we'll get up, we'll pray, God lead us. And as soon as something happens that's different from what we anticipated in our mind, then we start bucking and shouting and screaming and hollering. Come on, church, praise the Lord. How many of y'all know? God's not going to show you everything. It's like God knew I had some things to take care of, me and my wife, and he allowed for one of my tires to go flat. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. The Smith side of me got an attitude. I mean, come on, God, you know what I got to do, praise God. And here's the other thing, you know, being thrifty, following Dave Ramsey and trying to get my stick with the budget in the house and whatnot. I was like, God, come on, you know, I ain't trying to spend no money for no tires right now, praise God. What I didn't stop to think about was that God was keeping me from an accident on the road that was going to take my life. Come on, talk to me, somebody. See, he don't give you all the details, praise God, but you're struggling because it didn't work out the way you thought. But I want you to stop and think about the fact that this one here just might have kept you. Thank you, God. I walk out today. This is 2014. I walk out today a different man. Come on, somebody. Your faith level should have increased from 2013 to 2014. If nobody up, Mike and Nicole, I'm so excited about what God is doing for you all from 2013 to 2014. I got to keep drilling it. Now, that's just Exodus 14, right? Let me move on. I got a few more scriptures and I got to get out of here. Let me move on. This is good. I just want to endeavor to show you it's already done. I'm going to be quick as I can, and then we're going to move on. Can y'all see it?
Yes.
I can tell by those who are standing there in agreement already. They like what they're hearing. How many of y'all can see it?
Amen.
Elder Harris shared it with. He said, your faith comes by hearing.
Yes. Right.
Elder Harris has shared it. I'm going to try it again. Your faith comes by hearing.
Amen.
Shh, man. Can y'all see what God has for you? Listen, can you rejoice today knowing that truly, I mean, listen, I'm not looking for just an emotional response. I'm talking about a praise of agreement. Because what God is calling for is more mature Christians. Not people he got to show you everything and give you, oh, God, I feel a graduation upon us. Praise the Lord. He's moving us from milk to meat. I kept, Lord, this is good, God. Kept thinking about some stuff. God kept saying, you left your first works. And I said, huh? He said, yes. He said, I ordain, oh, God, help me, Holy Spirit. He said, I ordain you to preach about faith. I ordain you to live a life of faith. And to appease others, I shifted from that and started doing some other things. And you know what? I'm going right back to what God called me. When I started seeing an increase in this church, and I'm talking about growing, we were preaching about faith and faith in Christ. When I started preaching and working them faith principles, we saw it increase financially. And I mean, we just kept growing and growing. Okay. Let me see. That's what the Lord was saying. And you got, boy, I realized something. That's why we need the body of Christ. See, because he assigned me to deal with faith. But then there are others he assigned them to do other things. And it's God's will that we link up with them. Come on, church. It's God's will that we link up with them. Because no portion of the body has it all. Thank you, God. Let me hurry up. This is good. Geneva, I want to share with the church some stuff because I want them to know I ain't make this up. Mama Gail, I need for them to know I did not make this up. Minister Hutchinson, God's will is for your faith not to be contaminated anymore. Because I'm telling you, when your faith becomes contaminated, let me say it like this. Nikki, what happens to believers a lot of times is, watch this, and I think you'll be in agreement with this. If you find a person who's full of fear, and I mean very, very much full of fear, you'll see that stuff manifesting in life really quickly. And let me go a little further. What I'm saying is essentially this. People who are full of fear will say, oh, ain't nothing going to happen, and nothing happened. But on the other hand, if you're full of faith, the more to cause manifestation to come quicker. But you can't be half and half.
That's right.
See, because what can happen? Same thing happened to Jesus can happen to us in here. I can come and minister and talk. I mean, be in the Word of God concerning faith all day long and come in here with a bunch of people who live in fear, and you're going to short circuit. And how do I know that? Because Jesus said this. He says there were other works he wanted to do, but he couldn't do because of their unbelief. I believe Pastor Embry preached about this last week and let us know we don't believe God for enough stuff materialistically. What God has a problem with is we ain't really believing him for the spiritual stuff. God help me. Come on, church. Y'all. And let me let you know a secret. Keanu, he'll give you all the materialistic stuff if you seek the spiritual first. You don't even have to look for it. Them blessings will overtake you.
Yes.
Let me tell you, me and First Lady in the market again to get another vehicle. That's about all I'm going to tell you right now because it's not really important. So First Lady is thrifty. I mean, I said, honey, you know, you can get whatever you want to get, whatnot. I don't want to pay no more than this. And I thought to myself, you ain't going to find no car, not for what we're looking for that amount. Y'all not talking to me. That's, Pastor Chuck, that's what I said. We ain't going to find nothing. That's what I got that right in my spirit, Sherry. I said, we're not going to find nothing. I didn't say it, but I thought we ain't going to find nothing. Because the difference between faith and foolishness. We ain't going to find that. Let me tell you what the Lord began to do. My wife got online, went through a system, buying system we have through our company, and she found the automobile that was in her price range. Not only that, even before that happened, we was with one lady who was at the dealership. And lady was talking to whatnot. I said, let me tell you something about my wife. Because lady was looking, you know, all excited. She saw we drove up in and carrying on. Got excited. I said, let me tell you something. I said, that lady over there is cheap. My wife can tell you, it's honest, God, truth. You know what the lady said to me, Pastor? She said, I'm cheap too. I said, dear God. Needless to say, we walked out of there with nothing. But my purpose for telling you that was this. First lady's faith was such that she believed God to find her car for the price she wanted to pay. And I learned something from that, because guess what? Every time the devil shares something with you or offer you something, you don't have to take it.
Amen.
Okay. All right. Nikita, you getting anything today? Go forward. You done came, you done left Carolina, you came up here to Baltimore. It's a good thing, girl.
Amen.
Thank God for my amen corn over here. Mama Gail, I appreciate y'all. Some of the rest of y'all look at that glazed look. You ain't sure. Was it a good thing for her to come to Baltimore? This is good. Lord, this is good. Thank you, Mother Bennett. This is good. Now, I believe the word of God.
Yes.
Crystal, remind me, because I need to bless you for the kids for their birthday. I missed their birthday party. I'm going to make sure I take care of that. I believe the word of God.
Amen.
I'm not even going to apologize for it. I believe the word of God. Elder Harris, I believe the word of God.
Amen.
I believe. Okay, let me say it like this. I'm so wide open until really I want to get to the place where nothing God does surprises me.
Because
once you start trying to help him, as he moves Jonathan, you're going to become a blessing blocker based upon your thought process. Let me give you some scripture so you know what I'm talking about. People in Israel were struggling, and I'm so glad Elijah didn't struggle when God sent them dirty, filthy, unclean birds to feed him. That's what a raven is. I ain't talking about the Baltimore Ravens, but that's what a raven is. But watch this now. Watch this. God sent...
Amen.
Y'all can't get, y'all, I wish you could get it. I wish you, because see, your blessing, oh, help me, Holy Spirit. Your blessing is coming from the most unlikely place. Well, no, well, no, Lord, I, well, no, Lord, he's gay. I can't.
Come on, come on.
Isn't it funny how you can be blessed by artist music until you find out that they gay? Just one, y'all ready? I got to hurry up. I believe the word of God. Y'all believe the word of God? God, thank you, Holy Spirit. God loves us so much. Let me tell you something. God has a, he loves his people. He loves his, Mother Bennett, let me know, she had a stroke. Watch this, God, the Holy Spirit woke her up.
Amen.
We should be, I don't know how we do it. I don't know how, we should be praising God right now. I mean, that's just how I feel. The Holy Spirit woke her up so that the stroke would not complete itself. And look at her. Does she look like she has lost any mobility? Everything we need. Let's take this with us in the 2014. We have everything that we need. Ephesians chapter 1. We have everything that we need. We have everything that we need. I want you to see this because we're going. Look at Ephesians 1. Look at verse 3. And I want you, you got to be able to, well, first you need to believe it. I want you to see this first and then believe it. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I believe this with all my heart. Thank you, God, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Did everybody get that?
Amen.
Blessed be God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly, oh God, heavenly places in Christ. Thank you, Lord. Everybody, y'all receive that?
Yes.
Oh, I don't apologize. I just tell you because, like, what happens is I read a scripture, and God will bring something else to memory. Now, I want to share this with you, and I'm still talking about go forward. Sister Geneva, Sister Nikita, Brother Mike, this is amazing. I've never really seen this before in Scripture until I caught this through Dr. Bill Winston. Many times in our lives, Sister Burden, we speak to the leaves, Pastor Chuck, but we don't speak to the root. Remember when Jesus cursed that fig tree? Kiana, he cursed it at the root. Now, he cursed it. Now, watch this now. He cursed it at the root, Jeff. Watch this now, because he was trying to teach us to deal with the unseen first. You can't see the root. What you see is the leaves. What you see is the branches. And that's what we keep speaking to. And he's saying, no. If you really want to experience some great stuff in your life, you need to minister to the root. Minister to the unseen. Because watch this, as a result of ministering to the root, the entire tree dried up. And it wasn't until later the disciples come down the road and they see that tree dried up. But they're looking naturally when Jesus dealt with that bad boy spiritually first.
Amen.
God has already blessed us with all spiritual blessings. And I say that because even the natural things, they start spiritual first. In heavenly places in Christ. Verse 4, according as he hath chosen, oh man, how many of y'all know God chose you?
Yeah, yeah.
Chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. That's all I got time for, is just 3 and 4. Now, how many of y'all again believe the word? How many of you know and are willing to admit that probably the only thing standing between you and your blessing is that you don't know what's been written about you? You don't know what's been prophesied concerning your life. I'm going to take you to a couple of scriptures so you know exactly what Pastor knows what he's talking about. Many of us are stuck because God hasn't showed us the end yet.
Yes.
I was maybe a couple weeks ago, I was thinking, I was in my house sitting somewhere, and I began to think about the fact that when I first got married, even prior to getting married, I never saw myself being a pastor. I always wanted to be a deacon. That's really about it. Never saw myself being a pastor. I thought, my God, if God had showed me some of that stuff, I mean, how would it have changed my life? Other than I might have got puffed up at the wrong time. I could see myself at 7 telling somebody, don't talk to me like that. I'm a pastor. Look at this. I need your help. Look, go to Psalm 22 real quick. Y'all enjoying the word?
Yes,
sir. Psalm 22 real quick. Hurry up as quickly as you can. I just need to ask you a couple questions. I think you're going to be familiar with these scriptures. You're a sharp church. Psalm 22. Y'all ready?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to read it for you. Verse 1. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? When did we hear that before? Oh. Actually, forgive me. When did we hear that after? Now, let me tell you something. This is in the Psalms. This hadn't even happened yet. But yet this was prophesied about Jesus before he manifested himself, because he was always with the Father. Before he manifested himself, we see written, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, let me ask you a question. Did it come to pass?
Yes.
Drop. Thank you. That's what I'm getting at, Pastor Embry. Let's go to verse 18, Psalm 22, verse 18. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. Now, it's prophesied here in the Psalms, but when do we see that come to pass? In the New Testament, at the cross, where they're saying, man, you know, man, look at that gear. Think about that. He on Calvary. And they get his Ugg boots. I mean, think about that. But here's my point. Here's my point. Was it not prophesied hundreds of years ago? So you know what the trouble is, Crystal? We don't know what's been prophesied concerning us. And though we say we love God, Sister Geneva, do we really, really trust him? Do we really, really believe, Sister Merriman, that he's got it all under control? Do we really believe that, I mean, everything that we could ever need from God, we already have? All we got to do is continue to live out his will for our lives and to make sure our actions stanley line up with the word of God. God's got everything else under control. We keep stressing, Esther, about things that we have done. When God is really, you know what, all he wants you to do, if you did something wrong, ask God for forgiveness. He'll take care of it.
Amen.
But get back on track.
Yes.
Minister, do the things God has called you to do. He's going to take care of everything else. Watch this. Doesn't he always... So that was Psalm 22 and 1, Psalm 22 and 18. Oh, man, this is good. Go to Revelation 13 and verse 8. We're almost done. Revelation 13 and verse 8. This is good. Revelation 13 and verse 8. Revelation 13 and verse 8. We serve enough word in here for the devil to know we're not giving up. Revelation 13 and verse 8, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. When was the Lamb slain? Even though we didn't see it. Now, that's well over 6,000 years ago. We didn't see it till almost 2,000 years ago come to pass. But guess what? It was slain. He was slain before the
foundation of the world.
So what's God saying? It was all a part of his plan. Are we getting this? So here's my thing to you today. What has God written or said about you that you don't know about? And the only way to really find out is for you to spend some time with him.
Amen.
I can tell you fearfully and wonderfully made. I can tell you about some of the blessings and the promises God has for you, but it's really up to you to start to believe it and live that thing out. And watch this. And Jesus, if Jesus was here and walked the face of the earth and he did and went through the things that he did, I want you to know if he went through some stuff, you're going to go through some stuff too. But God is not going to leave you there. All God wants you to do is begin to see. Can you begin to see? Thank God for the 3 amens. Can you begin to see?
Amen.
I'm going to try to make it. It's 124. I'm going to try to do this by 130. Let's go to Genesis chapter 13 and verse 14 real quick. Y'all already know the story, I'm quite sure. Genesis chapter 13 and verse 14. Look what the Lord says. Genesis 13 and verse 14. Where am I at? Oh, I'm in Exodus. Forgive me, y'all. I knew that scripture didn't look right. Genesis 13 and verse 14. We got that?
Amen.
Mm. And the Lord said unto Abraham, or Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art northward and southward and eastward and westward. Verse 15, for all the land which thou seest to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. Now, when God speaks to us, we are, 99% of the time, we don't see how he's going to do it. And I got a few more scriptures, maybe three more. I'm going to try to be done by 1:30. All Robert God is asking for us to do is to see it. So as he begins to minister to me about this, I begin to see our new building. Yes. Amen. All of the things that I end up usually doing in my life, I see myself there first.
That's right. Amen.
That's all God is asking you to do is, can you see it? What we do, Mike, a lot of times is try to wrap ourselves into figuring out how's it going to be paid for. Yeah, the provision. Thank you. Somebody said it already. Yeah, how's it going to be? He didn't ask you to do all that, but can you see? Joshua chapter 6. This is good. God is amazing. This comes at a time for which, shut up, Smith, and move on. Now, Joshua was straightly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see? Brother Mike, can you see it? You got a powerful testimony coming. Brother Eddie, can you see it? I won't even ask you, can you see? You just say, yeah. He said, yeah. You got to see it to believe it. Nobody coming in and out. People kind of positioned. It don't look like everything's shut up. It look like ain't nothing happening, Deacon Jason. You got to see it to believe it. So glad Pastor Chuck said, I remember, man, we sat right up here at the little front row when the benches was here, and he was like, oh, that faith speak stuff don't work. Ever since he said that, he'd been getting blessed.
Amen.
See, what happens is you got to put stuff in motion. Deacon Joe, you shared it during the tithing testimony. You got to plant a seed. The harvest don't come the next day. Might take some time since the alchemist, but it's coming. It's coming. The Lord told Joshua, he said, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho and the king thereof and the mighty men of valor. Last scripture, Exodus chapter 7. This is good. Anybody enjoying the word? Exodus chapter 7. Go forward. That's where I'm going. Go forward. Exodus chapter 7. Ah, man, what a mighty God we serve. Woo. Nikita, you got everything you need. Already, I hope you know it. You got everything you need already. I'm going to give the church a little exercise. I feel like God is going to do us like he did Solomon. The only person I know of in scripture that I can remember at this moment anyway, where God dealt with him doing like doing a dream and said, listen, anything you want, I'm going to give to you. Or there's another scripture that I think will allow me to pull everybody into this. He said, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you're able to ask or think, but it's according to the what's your capacity to receive from God like? No, really. See, because I see it. Can I tell y'all something else? Y'all remember not too long ago, you know, I shared with you, if you remember, hopefully, we were ministering the word of God, and I was telling the church how the same way God had filled the church up. We kind of light today because people sick and traveling, all that kind of stuff. But church, God had filled the church up. And so I was talking to the televised audience, and I pay attention to how many viewers we got and stuff like that. And the Lord told me the same way that you exercised your faith and God filled up the seats is the same way you need to exercise your faith and God's going to start growing our televised ministry. But get this. And then I was believing God, Brother Robert. I said, well, Lord, we need finances. Other things that you know, you want us to do. I don't want to tax the people and whatnot. And God said, you just exercise your faith. I was either in Kentucky or I was even home. My wife said, honey, do you know a person by the name of such and such? And I said, say it again. She said, yeah, do you know a person by the name of such and such? And I said, yeah, I think so. I won't give you all the details, but they made a significant contribution.
Amen.
Over the internet.
Amen.
So what's my point? It starts somewhere. You got to see it. So when you all see Pastor at the end of the service, thank those people who are streaming live with us, and I say certain things about pray and be sensitive and allow the Holy Spirit to lead you where you can make a charitable donation, I'm talking in the spirit.
Amen.
Because I can't tell you how many Sabbaths I had given that greeting and nothing came through PayPal. But how many of y'all know I ain't moved by what I
see?
So he says here, Exodus chapter 7, verse 1. And the Lord said unto Moses, there's that word again, see? Look at this. Look at this. He didn't even know this. He said, I have made thee a god to Pharaoh. Good mugger. And Aaron, thy brother, shall be thy prophet. I'll stop there. So while you fighting with the enemy, or you fighting against the system, how do you not know that? How do you know that God hasn't ordained that for you in order for you to be propelled to your next blessing in Him? The answer to that is we don't. Who in here today can see? Who in here today has been encouraged to go forward? I know I have. I'm not giving up. As long as I got breath in me, I'm going to keep fighting. Watch this. Not people, but I am going to fight the good fight of faith. Would you stand to your feet today? What other kind of way is there for you to stand? I'm sorry. Would you please stand? I'm just thinking about stand to your elbow. No, would you please stand? Thank you, every last one of you that took time out of your busy schedules to worship with us today via streaming live. As you heard me mention a few moments ago, it's because of people like you who remain prayerful and sensitive to the Holy Spirit that make those charitable donations that enable us to remain on the air. So we want to encourage you to do that. The most important thing is, for anybody who's watching me that does not know the Lord Jesus Christ, Romans chapter 10 says that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord died, that He rose again, and the Bible says thou shalt be saved. Contrary to what you may have heard, it's just that simple. Give your life to Jesus Christ. He is the difference maker. After you have done that, you want to find yourself a good church home where you can grow under a good pastor, hearing good teaching and good preaching, and you'll experience the promised abundant life. So listen, once again, thank you for taking time out to worship with us on today. We hope we've been a blessing to you. And as we close out on today, you ain't seen nothing yet. The best is yet to come. God bless you.